reality is that if you're sick, you want to go to a specialist centre, and I'm trying to deliver that by proposing this plan.
Can I make just two brief responses? Make 2 points here. Just in response to this question, I'll make two replies very briefly. First is, if it is a sin for a Member of Parliament to represent the general interests of their constituents, then really we are wasting our time. Now, I've tried to take the most principled position I can, which is to say what I say. I say it again. If the clinical commissioning groups back it, I will back it. I will back them and back it. And that is the best I can do. Philip is able to talk on the authority of his own profession and experience. If we were having a conversation about the airworthiness of aero engines, or how to design something called an XBRL taxonomy for financial reporting, I could tell you all about it. But I'm not a doctor, I'm an engineer. So I will back our local clinical commissioning group if they back it. And that is really as far as I can go.
Yeah, I mean, I think, to be honest, that's the reality of the situation we find ourselves in, is that the commissioning groups will determine this. I am somewhat anxious about them having the final say because, yet again, you enter into vested interest territory. And I've certainly got that problem on my patch. So I understand that that's the reality of it. I'm encouraged, though, that I think in reality, because of the pressures upon the health service nationally, locally, are getting bigger and bigger and bigger, that there is a pressure upon foundation trusts to respond to that reality. I think that might play into our favour in terms of supporting this process.
Well, thank you very much. Well, there's a gentleman down here that...
Yes, and I'd just like to say something in support of Dr. Lee's super hospital. I've got some paediatrics on that now. I've seen evidence of paediatric care that the death rates in hospitals like Bristol, John Radcliffe,
you ask me the question, sir.
Well,
I will feed out back what you've asked.
Yeah, so there's obviously evidence that centres of excellence where surgeons who are skilled and trained in a certain discipline, yes, it could be cardiovascular or pediatric, would be concentrated in centres of excellence, so therefore it would actually reduce the problem of perhaps.
Essentially, the question is about the consolidation of specialist services, as you've seen with pediatric cardiovascular surgery, has recently been an announcement to reduce the number of pediatric cardiovascular units. Interestingly, I've been asked to support a proposal to reduce the number of orthopaedic specialist units in Britain. The orthopaedic fraternity seem to believe that a consolidation of their services into specialist centres is also advisable. After my speech yesterday, the Royal College of Paediatrics president tweeted that I was courageous and right, and as did a renal specialist as well. I'm confident that the majority of my profession understand and are supportive of the principle of hub and spoke provision of care, acute being the hub, spokes out to chronic care. I think that, there's not much more I can say on it. So I think that increasingly that surgery is becoming, I mean, the procedure my father's just done is not done around here. Okay, so it's increasingly specialised and it's increasingly expensive, and that is something which we all have to accept as the reality. And I want to live in a world where everybody has access to the best care that is affordable. And I think the one way of trying to guarantee that is by having a hospital infrastructure that is resilient and as cost-effective going forward. You know, I mean, it's not a surprise that in this room, the predominant colour of hair is grey. I see this in practice. We have an ageing population. The baby boomers are going to start hitting the National Health Service hard in the 2020s. and their attitudes towards pain and suffering, if I shall say this gently, are somewhat different to their parents' generation. Their parents' generation saw people die, saw people come back from war, injured and suffering. And so their parents' generation, and they are still alive, some of them are very stoic, they come in and often apologise for taking up my time. You only have to go 10, 15 years younger and you encounter a generation, and I'm talking in broad terms, whose expectations and attitudes are profoundly different. And all I can say is those expectations and attitudes point towards increased expense. And I think if we're all realistic and all honest about it, we do need to put in place an infrastructure that can withstand that level of expectation. I don't believe, and this is a personal opinion, that we have a system and infrastructure capable of withstanding that onslaught of expectation in the 2020s. And I think the sooner that we grasp that nettle and put into place decisions to deal with it, the better.
Well, thank you very much. There's a gentleman in the structure here.
Just a quick question. What would you think, just as a broad outline, the timescale for such a thing would be, you know, if everything went reasonably well? Are we talking in my lifetime?
I hope so. The hospital that I sort of based this on was the one that was built in Norwich. Mm-hmm. I certainly don't want to copy the financing of that hospital, and I don't get part of political with any PFI on the previous administration. It was an utter disgrace. And so I think the financing of it I wouldn't copy, but the size and the structure, and essentially Norwich has gone through the pain of consolidation of acute services. I'm pretty sure that took about 5 or 6 years. I don't quote me on that, but it's that, from the actual decision to go for it. I mean, once you've actually decided to go for it, I mean, the piece of land that I've sort of highlighted is Greenbelt, but it is bordered by three roads, the Hollyfoot Road, the bypass into Maidenhead and the M4, and there are some issues. Actually, the highways agency has already bought pieces of it to try and get a piece of spur onto the M4. So there are, you know, the idea that you're not going to get planning permission, I think, is unlikely. And so once you've actually started, there are enough hospitals already built of a similar size in the country which you've got plans for. Now, you know, my report is not complete, it's not perfect. It was written primarily by my researcher, Eva, who's here on the front, and myself, and we put it together in our spare time, because guess what, I'm also a member of Barbara Bracknell, the doctor. And so I recognise it's not perfect, and we did it within the resources of my office. So I don't expect to be able to say, oh, well, here we go, this is how we do it. It's not like that. What I was suggesting was what was on offer to the community if they made a few difficult decisions on hospital sites that they presently have. I think there's no reason, in theory, why it can't be up and running by 2020. So do I think it's going to be? No. Okay, because I unfortunately don't have £500 million in my back pocket of public money that I can get a book.
Oh, I know a man who does.
I do think though that I've been surprised at the broad support I've received. I was expecting much more parochial attack, if you get that understanding. As in, I thought people would be very sort of parochial and I want to hear. I've been surprised at how many people have said, yeah, I think you're right. They get the argument. And so, yeah, I mean, I'm hopeful that it will take place in my political careers.
Can I just make a concern? Can I just add a point to that? One of the things I've commented on before, again, probably in here, is the cycle of rumour and despair that surrounds Wycombe Hospital. And we're going through it again now. Somebody told me as I came in, an ambulance driver told a friend that something. And it's just hearsay. But it's so destructive, because as soon as it comes out, everybody worries about it. Now, I think there are two ways, this is the second way I've come across, that we might escape this awful cycle of despair. The first that I've been proposing, which would be long-term with our big political choices, is for hospitals to be owned by local mutuals, friendly societies, so that you actually owned it.
you appointed the board of directors, and you'd be entitled to all the information. That'd be one way to do it. But it does seem to me that another way to do it is for people on a grander scale than this to actually positively opt in and say that they want back this proposal. So, I mean, if you can get the numbers, if the clinical commissioning groups back it, then I suggest we would be making progress.
Well, I would add one thing is that when I was at the local surgery, is that a doctor actually sort of said, yeah, brilliant idea, but it's getting it off the ground. And I said, but hang on a minute, is you are the people who are actually servicing the community in terms of their health. Would you, as a doctor, not want the best that you could possibly give them? And if so, then you have to go for this. And he shrugged his shoulders and didn't disagree. So.
Yeah, I mean, just finally, the funding, I mean, it does seem like a lot of money. I would suggest that in view of the fact that £20 billion a year, just in business rates, is transferred from the South East region to the rest of the country, you know, 500 million quid is peanuts. Secondly, the sale off of assets, I mean, it's very difficult at the moment to value property and to value how many properties, homes, or whatever you could get on a site. But, you know, ballpark figures of hundreds of millions of pounds aren't far off for some of these sites. I mean, both St Mark's and Heatherwood Hospital are in very attractive developable sites. I mean, Heatherwood between Royal Ascot Racecourse and Ascot Railway Station, and St Mark's in the centre of Maidenhead. And if you are reducing the size of Wycombe and reducing the size of Upton, they're both central London, a central city to a town locations. And so I do think that there are assets to be sold which can at least fund part of this, I would suggest at least 50%. And so I think, you know, there's a deal to be done here. You just have to be courageous. You have to just say, right, we're going to do this and get on with it.
Gentleman in the blue.
Thank you.
Look at that.
Paul Henry, Children's CCG.
Sorry? I didn't catch any of
that. And Children's Clinical Commissioning Group. The problem that we have is that the CCGs at the moment are not statutory. They have no power yet, as you know, we're in shadow. We don't actually come into power, as it were, until next year. So I know from my perspective, personally, it sounds like a really good idea. My colleagues have discussed it off the record, but it hasn't been tabled as an idea. When it is discussed, however, the issue arises in our minds that what we cannot have is that the current plans are blighted by this plan. There are plans in place, for instance, to make Heatherwood Hospital to build a new hospital at Heatherwood and make it a cold site for elective surgery. There are plans afoot at Wrexham Park to develop. And there is a danger that those plans will be frozen because this spectre of a large hospital, which may take 10 years to come to fruition, is on the horizon. And that, I think, is the great fear, is that the spectre is stopping the progress.
Yeah, I mean, I recognise that, Paul. It's the age-old problem of dealing with the now and planning for the future. And, you know, that's why we've got an airport that's not fit for purpose. And I recognise that, and my intention is stuck with the status out there to stir it up and cause trouble, to be honest with you, because you only have to go to every hospital site I've ever worked in and visited. An exercise in bolt on this, bolt on that, bolt on this, bolt on that. There's never a sense of strategy. They just make the amend. And that's what they're doing in the Heatherwood and Wrexham Trust, is make the amend and desperately. And it's this perverse situation where the majority of patients treated at Heatherwood Ascot live in slab. You know, I get this on the doorsteps of Bracknell, you should be defending Heatherwood. And I said, what? So that they can provide care for the residents of slab. What do you mean? I said, well, majority of patients at Heatherwood are being, and they're literally busing them over and taxiing them over from Slough to try to make Heatherwood viable. And I sit in a GP surgery and I have to refer patients from Slough to Heatherwood because Wrexham is closed. nuts. It's madness. And yet, because the system is creaking, and it's creaking under the weight of demand, I mean, the slough itself, because it's got a growing immigrant population, the maternity unit is completely overflowing with polls, we all know it, I'm not saying that it isn't true, and as a consequence, the maternity unit at Heatherwood has been closed. I might add, I'd call for it not to be reopened, because I don't like midwifery units. Midwifery load units, I don't like. If you want me to tell you why, I'll point you in the direction of some literature in comparing and contrast obstetric led units with midwifery led units.
May I just make a point on that?
I know that's controversial.
There's a real problem with this. Is if you had a midwife here, midwife also refers to literature. And there's a real there is a massive clash. Where Philip knows this. There's a massive clash between midwives and doctors about.
Can I just say there's a massive clash between midwives and doctors? It's over this as over anything else. I guess the point is, broad conclusion is yes, I understand it causes difficulties, but I'm sorry, it's about time those difficulties were caused, because in 1989 it was recommended that Wexham closed and they built a hospital at Junction 89. And guess what? I'm not doing that, that's a bit too much of a step. Wish they'd done it. Now, where are we now, 20 odd years later?
Gentleman in the black jacket, and then the lady down here in the purple.
Hi, my name's Chris Ford, I'm from Beaconsfield, but I have family across the Marlow and Wycombe area, so they will all be affected by the proposal before. May I just say, it takes quite some considerable guile to propose closing the hospital in one's own constituency, so I think that's credit to you that you've...
And enhanced the clinic that we have.
Yeah.
I'm not saying we're having no healthcare, but sure. It's a motive for being
quite. My question to you is this, really. You've come up with a plan, and it looks like you've gone and done quite a lot of work on this, and it's not without merit, but have you taken this and put it in front of health ministers and the Department of Health? What have their reaction been? What have they said to you about whether or not this should be used as a pilot, and if it's quite a successful idea? Why aren't they banging the door down to make this happen?
Yes, I have. And look, I'll give you an example of the situation I found. I was in the DOH 2 years ago and discussing health and social care. You think that the only practicing GP in the Houses of Parliament might have been asked for an opinion. And I was pointing out to them that some concerns, and I ended up voting for it because in broad terms I supported the concept of commissioning. At one of those meetings I asked the question whether they had a hospital closure plan in the Department of Health. And they looked at me and said, what do you mean? And I said, well, the direction of travel is this, it's irrespective of how much money you spend. And there was just no acknowledgement at all of the need to look at where hospitals are and where they need to be in the future. I said I was embarking upon trying to do this project at that point. And that was it. I've since sent copies of this to all of the previous health team. They will now be in place, but the previous health team had all the copies of it. I had, to be honest, one of the ministers, the junior ministers, was warm in response and acknowledged it. In the end, it did. I'm left in a situation where the Department of Health itself, the civil servants, didn't seem to get it and didn't seem to want to deal with it. And that was surprising. I think, sir, to be honest with you, and I'm sure I'll leave Steve to have his own opinion, Whitehall is an interesting place to inhabit. It's like wading through a treacle. It's frustrating. But it is how it is. I'm pretty confident that I'm on the right side of this in terms of the sort of the evidence and the arguments to be made. I think I'm unusual in that I am saying something openly as a politician that involves a reconfiguration of services, and that I'm actually saying that it's a positive thing, something that can be grasped and we can actually deliver better healthcare. But I do think, though, that the numbers are increasing of people who are beginning to realise that I'm actually not a complete political naive operator, but I'm actually looking at this sensibly and trying to deliver something. I'm quite tired generally, I got quite tired generally as a voter of politicians who didn't tell it as it is, who told people what they wanted to hear. And it's about time that it stopped. And I thought, well, I'm now in the bar, so I have to walk the walk. And so it's an area that Steve is right, I can feel, I can sound eloquent and et cetera on the subject because it's something I've been doing over a decade. But I think it really is important across the board, actually, that people start backing politicians who perhaps tell you something you don't really want to hear. Think about why they're telling you it, because it's important. Because the future generations, of which you're probably one of the youngest people in the room, it's not going to be there for you when you need it at this rate. And I don't think that's fair. And I think we all have a responsibility to pass on a resilient country, a country that is sustainable in all ways in the future. And I choose that the only way you can do that in the hospital sector is by implementing what I suggested for the Thames Valley across the entire country. And I think in time it will happen.
Lady in the purple, and then I'll take a question from the lady at the back.
Okay. A 1,000-bedded hospital is going to take an awful lot of staff, and I would like to ask Dr. Lee, in view of the present day acute shortage of medical staff, what he proposes not to get it, to enable this to happen at the same time as the hospital is finished?
And that's a good question. First of all, there is now a doctor on employment.
There is what?
There's doctor unemployment in Britain. Okay, which is a new phenomenon, and it's going down, as you imagine, not very well with the medical profession. Junior doctors are struggling to find work and training posts because the previous government tried to train too many in proportion to the number of immigrant doctors who came in who, funnily enough, decided to stay. That's the truth. That's what's happened. So there aren't a shortage of medical staff. Having said that, if you're consolidating, I'm closing Wexham Park. Those doctors are going to go somewhere. I'm reducing the size of what I'm moving the acute provision of care from Heatherwood and from Wycombe onto this site. So those doctors will follow that path. So I don't think staffing in terms of the medical staff is a challenge. Yes, I think in terms of the rest of the staff at the hospital, I think it is challenging. But going back to what was said earlier, really, around here, we don't need a significant amount of economic growth. I think you'll find that funny to say, for me to say that, but I've been saying it repeatedly in Bracknell, but with economic growth comes the pressure on infrastructure, housing and the like. And I've grown up with 40 years of my life around here. How many houses, business parks, industrial estates have been built in this neighborhood over the last 40 years? What we actually are short of in this area are jobs for unskilled people, not for skilled people so much. And actually hospitals need a significant number of unskilled people working. And so actually, going back to the contribution from the start, there are important opportunities here for people who at the moment are struggling to get jobs. And I suppose the final thing I'd say, sorry I feel like I'm going on. Two things. One, I don't know if you noticed, but this the latest hospital site, new airport site, suggested by a latest consortium are in Berkshire and Buckinghamshire. One of them is Twyford, for a four-terminal, four-runway site in Twyford, just north of my constituency. Now, it's not decided, but it just shows you that people are beginning to look for new sites for airports. One that I think is in Banbury, and there's a series of them. At the moment, as it stands, in the Thames Valley, Oxford is a trauma centre. The whole of the Thames Valley doesn't have a primary trauma centre. Not doesn't exist. So we have Crossrail, we have the Great Western Railway as was, we have the M40, we have the M4, we have how many people working, travelling in and out of the area, what's it like when the Marlow bypass goes into Ripley. All of these people, all of these potential will become somewhere where medical students come. And when medical students come to a hospital, you can guarantee the consultants who want to work at those hospitals tend to improve in standard because they want to be in a teaching hospital themselves, because they want to have an impressive department that does research, that attracts pharmaceutical industry investment, etc., etc. It is a virtuous circle that you can create here and deliver a much better hospital than we have at the moment.
Dr. Gamble.
Thank you. My name is Nat Gamble, I'm a local GP, and I am the Chief Clinical Officer for Chiltern Clinical Commissioning Group. So that is the CCG that covers South Buckinghamshire and the Chiltern District. So we go as far in the north as Great Missenden, in the west as Stoke Mandeville, in the east we've got Cheshire, Manchester, and we go down as far south as Iver. Okay, so some of that area is covered by... Firstly, I'd like to say how much we do welcome this proposal and the debate and the discussion. It does parallel a similar debate and discussion and review that went on between 2009 and 2011, reported in 2011, that was Care for the Future, which was a regional review that involved Milton Keynes, Oxfordshire, Buckinghamshire, Berkshire West and Berkshire East. I would echo what Dr. Lee said earlier, that the traditional district hospital as we know it was a model built for the 60s. It was a bed-based model. In Buckinghamshire, we've got three buildings which were effectively three district general hospitals. Findings from Care for the Future absolutely talked about hub and spoke for the hospital-based services and improved and enhanced community and primary care services to deal with long-term conditions and chronic care and demographics that we are already facing and will rapidly increase. You mentioned building a resilient structure. This is leading me to my question. The three hospitals that we have in Buckinghamshire are all PFI buildings. I would want to focus my point here on Amersham Hospital, which isn't mentioned at all in your proposal, which is a PFI building, an old building which was rebuilt to be state-of-the-art, and is state-of-the-art, 10 to 15 years ago, because the vision was you need a big hospital, you need more surgical facilities, etc., etc. How quickly things have moved on. So I do worry about moving on and proposing to put all our eggs in one basket when healthcare is changing very, very rapidly. The hub and spoke vision in Buckinghamshire fits in with the Better Healthcare in Bucks consultation, which is closed, and the reconfiguration, which is due to happen later in the year, so that Stoke Mandeville becomes the centre, the hub, and the other hospitals around become the spokes. You said that Wycombe's a cold site. In fact, it's not. It's a hot site networked with Stoke. So in this area, if someone has a stroke or a heart attack, they actually go to Wycombe, which does have a coronary care unit, a regional hyper-acute stroke unit, and critical care units. So my question then is twofold. What do we do about the PFI buildings, which we do have with very long payment terms, that we as Sisters of Bucks will need to continue to pay for? And remember, and it was in the report, we are the third lowest funded health economy in the country. And my second question, again around the buildings, is that Stoke has been refurbished, and this goes to Paul Henry's point, my colleague over here, building on the Care for the Future proposals about hub and spoke. So we have a centre there that is a centre of excellence and will be more so when we centralise special services there. A local hospital needs to be functional, needs about 500,000 population. So that South Bucks activity need would go southwards. What happens to Stoke Mandeville? Does a similar proposal happen northwards, and do we end up in Buckinghamshire where we have actually no acute hospital services?
Okay, I mean, can I have
Sorry, can I just add that the CCGs just welcome this debate and haven't made our minds up?
Yeah, sure. Going back to what Paul Henry said, there is always this legacy challenge that you're. I must say, Stoke Mandeville Hospital is not an appropriate location for a hub. I mean, the transport links into Stoke Mandeville Hospital are just not good enough. And I think the fact that decision was made is probably because that was the only decision that could be made unless we started again. And it's the same old, unfortunately. And I worked there for 2 years, so I don't have any problem with Stoke Mandeville itself. I trained there as, I did my GP training scheme there, so I know it well. But it's just not in the right location. I think with reference to Amersham, forgive me, I wasn't alone in thinking that development should never have been embarked on in the first place. I don't know which trend they were following, but I found the development at Amersham inexplicable, and I couldn't quite work out who had driven it through. It's a lovely facility, yet again, in the wrong location. And I think that, and I didn't mention it in the in my plan, because I had to draw the line somewhere, and also because I knew that the ugly PFI was going to erupt, and the sort of legacy of all of that. I think that whatever you do here, you're going to have this problem of, well, what about so-and-so, what about so-and-so. Mid and North Bucks is earmarked for significant house building, as I recall, significant numbers of houses, new villages being created. I suspect there's probably an argument for rolling Milton Keynes into Stoke Mandeville. This then falls onto the problem, the challenge one has, where the DOH are not prepared to put together a national plan and centralise their decision making on where these hospitals should be located. Look at the population density, look at the projections of ageing, whatever, all the other demographics, and say, right, we need a hospital there. How is that going to work? How is it going to play out politically? And I wish that had been done. I wish it was ongoing now. I see no evidence of it. So we are left with a situation, which you quite rightly point out, of dealing with legacy issues over the PFRs and the fact that previous decisions were made to create hubs in locations that are demonstrably not appropriate to have a hub at. And I don't make any apology for putting a spanner in the works and for the sort of challenging decisions that have been made in the past, because I don't think they were good decisions. I'm putting this forward as an honest appraisal and trying to work with what we've got, but actually concluding that hospitals have to be on motorway. It just seems obvious to me that hospitals have to be located on minimums of bypasses with motorways. And that has to be the way forward. And if that means more helicopters, well, they're only 2 million a pop. I mean, for granted, that's a lot of money. It's cheap as chips if it means that you will be serving